I look back, my best friends are probably encapsulated. I come all the way from Spain, Madrid. My first year in camp was 2007, and since then I've been going to camp through 5 years. Then I've taken some summers off. So it came to my mind that the first thing I should do with my first paycheck is come to Camp Kawani and also get to see all these people in New Year's. Just the first view of camp, it was just incredible. You're looking at something that is so beautiful and so nice, but at the same time, so many memories from summer comes to your head. Like the brotherhood you had at camp, when the generations go past and year goes past, you still maintain that feeling, and this is thanks to camp. You know, when I look back right now after all these years, I just can't be more thankful that I was there. To all the campers, I would say just take advantage of your time there and make sure you remember every single moment of it.
So some of you guys may know, me and Brandon are friends at camp, but we're also friends at home. And to kick things off, we're going to take you guys on a walk from here at Brandon's house all the way to my house, which is about the distance from the tennis courts to Council Ground. Let's do it. So we just got here after walking from Brandon's house to my house. We watched a pretty good sunset. It wasn't quite a well-made sunset, but it was pretty decent nonetheless. We built a fire, and I'm gonna throw it off to Brandon to introduce the videos for this week.
So this week, we got a couple great videos coming at you. First off, we're gonna start with a skit from Grant. Then thereafter, a Mario coffee harvest video. And then after that, a day in the life of Colin Holstein.
So we got some birthday wishes this week. Big birthday shout out Paul Calcagni and Leo Marvin.
And I would like to wish a happy birthday to Alec Russo and Colin Mokas. So next summer, we'll be throwing you guys a lake twice.
We will now light the central fire of the Great Spirit.
Ka-ni-do-go-na.
Man, I love mindlessly chopping wood.
Stop! In the age of the coronavirus, this is not enough. You need 6 feet. This is only 2.5. We need a bigger, more powerful axe to protect our public. Introducing the Coronavirus Protection Axe. It's like an axe, but it's 6 feet. Wow, look at that, 6 feet.
Thanks, Coronavirus Protection Axe.
Legally classified as a medieval weapon, I spent 6 months perfecting this bad boy so our junior man guides could train and become the best they can be even in the middle of a pandemic.
With the Coronavirus Protection Axe, you can do safety circles.
Flirt with chicks.
So,
try to chop wood.
I don't feel safe.
Do it, you coward!
But don't just take it from me. Listen to these other satisfied customers.
Yeah, I like to add a 10-pound dumbbell just to add a little beef to the arm. You know, if somehow we can put a circular fin on it that can hold a fart bomb, we can throw it into lodges and stink them.
This contraption is dangerous and foolhardy, and if the AC finds out, they could shut camp down. So if you want to get yourself a Coronavirus Protection Axe, head on down to the camp store.
Oh, wait. Yep, okay.
All right, I just got a call from Macy. We legally cannot sell them at the camp store, so buy it on Amazon.
The Coronavirus Protection Act. It's totally not tamper-proof. Only 6 words of $100. Call or text today at 1-800-KADI-DO-GO-NA because that is a totally real number.
Hi, everybody. My name is Mario Grazia. I'm here in the beautiful mountains of Ayuya, Puerto Rico. I just want to share you guys something pretty cool that's been going on the farm for some time now, probably like 30-plus years, which is coffee plantation, harvesting, and, you know, all the processes that make coffee so great. So, this is coffee. I want to show you around the coffee bean plantation. This is the coffee grove. It's a super nice berry. There are different kinds or different sizes of berries like this. And then you got full size ones that are like this that are pretty much ready to harvest. See, what you want to do is get the ripest ones just like that and then put them in your bucket. So most, if not all, the coffee that you drink is picked by hand like this. Really appreciate where your coffee comes from. You can buy fair trade or, you know, coffees that you know the origin of. Oh, that's great. We're here in the dome where we're doing our fermenting and drying. My grandfather Humberto, he's turning the coffee. Every couple of days you turn it because you want all that humidity to go out of the grain gradually. You can see this one is from a little bit later. This one is completely fresh. That's been fermenting for about 2 days now on a bucket with water. This is how it looks before the roasting process. You see it has a little bit of a greenish color to it. I'm gonna load it in this 3.5-pound toaster. It's basically a drum that goes around and around, and it has a burner, a gas burner. So this has been in the toaster for about an hour and 15 minutes, and I've let some of the coffee out so you can see that it's starting to become dark brown. All right. This new one that's coming out is a little bit darker. And this is really close to what we want. This is still a pretty light roast. Coming out a lot of smoke. This is perfect.
Oh, the smell is so nice.
And now I'm gonna
gonna prepare an espresso. It's early in the morning, so I need that coffee boost that everybody looks for. This is the beautiful product that you get. Hopefully, you have a good cup of coffee today too. So hopefully everybody's safe. Cheers. Miss you all. Bye-bye.
Hey, Kawani family. Currently away from my co-host, Eddie, but we're in Manchester-by-the-Sea, Massachusetts, and it's currently high tide, but at low tide, we're gonna walk out to that island that you see right there. Stay tuned. It's currently low tide. We got a lot of boats out here. We're gonna walk to the island now. Let's do it. So we've made it to the island, and surprisingly, there's a lot of trash, so we're gonna at least try to pick up 10 pieces of trash before we leave. Practice and leave no trace. Let's do it. That's one. That's two. Three. Sometimes you gotta stop to admire the view. That's 10. All right, here we got our 10 pieces of trash. Tide's coming in a little bit, so let's make our way back. We'll be able to clean this place up and leave it better than we found it. Kawani way. We made it back to the mainland, all of our trash. Let's go.
Well, thanks for coming with me on this Leave No Trace adventure. Remember to always leave a place better than you found it, even if you didn't have anything to do with the trash that was already there. So, Eddie, see you back in Newton.
Welcome back. Here we are from the Gaga court. Just got done playing a game of Gaga with Lady Gaga herself. She's around here somewhere. Lady Gaga! Okay, she's probably already left. But here we go with three general knowledge trivia questions. So we, of course, have the Electoral College is the way we elect our presidents. Hope you've learned something about that at school. But there have been some cases where a presidential candidate has won the popular vote but lost the Electoral College and thus were not elected president. How many presidents in our history have actually won the popular vote and not won the Electoral College vote and thus were not elected president? Second question, probably pretty easy one. What object did Benjamin Franklin attach to the end of a kite string to prove that lightning is electricity? What object did Benjamin Franklin attach to the end of a kite string to prove that lightning is electricity? And question number three. Every year, Sports Illustrated and other media outlets pick an athlete of the year. And probably one of the most unique ones was in 1973, when the athlete of the year wasn't even a human being. Who was selected as athlete of the year in 1973 and was not even a human being? How many presidents in our history have won the popular vote but not the Electoral College vote? Four. Four candidates. Samuel Tilden in 1876, Grover Cleveland, Al Gore in 2000, and just recently, 2016, Hillary Clinton. Question number two. The answer, what object did Benjamin Franklin attach to the end of a kite string? A metal key. We will accept just a key. And the third question, kind of an interesting one. What non-human was picked as athlete of the year in 1973. Of course, that was the famous horse secretary.
Good morning, Camp Kawani. We are here in the lovely Columbus, Ohio. It's about 6:55 in the morning. I figure it's right around the time that we'd be hiking Katahdin. So not only are we going to do a little bit of polar bear, we're going to act as if though we are at the bottom of a glacier.
I'm going to fill this tub here full of ice. I'm going to do some polar bear.
All right, we got the tub all filled up here. It's nice spicy in here. Take the docks. Shake it out. One for the money. Two for the show. Three to get ready. And four to go. Everything's going my way, up and at odds.
Oh, well, hello there. Just doing a little food prep here, getting ready for the day. Right here we have our classic Kawani breakfast. We're doing a little lunch prep as well, getting ready for the day. We have some fresh coffee, so we're going to try to find some hiking in the depths of Columbus, Ohio, and let's see what we can do.
Every time I hear this song this summer, I have been thinking it would be a camp song. I know it would have been. I'm sure a lot of you guys feel the same way. So without further ado, here we go.
River Wetlands Research Park. They have some critters here to walk around and see what we can find. And you come across a little young buck over here. Perhaps an eagle lodger. I don't know, he might be falcon, but it's the little things, you know? It's not a moose, but we'll take it. Going about our business here. Hey, buddy. Oh, and he is looking right at us. He's engaging us. And he's gone.
Here we are at Owentangy National River Bridge. Doesn't look like I can take a kayak off this anytime soon. I'll leave that to Aiden Doherty. The water's not swimmable, the air is breathable, and we're living.
Kawanee-go-go-na! Kawanee-go-go-na!
All right, I'm here at the Park of Roses. I think what I've come across here is the JC's next project.
Kawanee don't go now!
Sometimes you just gotta stop and smell the roses.
Oh, it's not moose tracks, but it is good.
Alright, well, there you have it. Thank you for joining me for a day of activities here in Columbus. Sometimes life unexpectedly throws some punches at you. I know we're expecting to be in Maine this summer. Sometimes things don't go the way you plan, but you gotta roll with the punches, get back on your feet, embrace change, and make the best of it.
Ah, the rumors are true. She's abandoned.
In the name of the Kawanee Sailing Department, I hereby claim this beach, these boats, this diving crib, and this amazing houseboat as ours forever. They may have taken our Jolly Roger, but they haven't taken our spirit. How shall I spread the message?
The message.
message in a bottle.
To the great Kawani sailing crews scattered across the lands. It is true, Kawani has been abandoned. And I have claimed the entirety of the waterfront for the Kawani Sailing Department. Beware of the dreaded boating, kayaking, and swimming departments, for their spies are everywhere.
Now light the central fire of the great Jolly Roger.
This is an official declaration of the sailing department claiming the entire waterfront. And to further prove our superiority,
we challenge the waterfront staff to a sing-off.
Thank you.
This week we've got the Spirit of Camp from Home Challenge. It was introduced by Ferd a couple weeks ago.
So for this challenge, Ferd asked you guys to submit anything from camp that you have at home, whether it's your paddle, camp memorabilia, medals, anything. He just wanted you guys to send in some videos to show off anything you got that has to do with camp. And we got some awesome submissions this week, so let's see them.
Let's do it.
Hello, Kawanee family. This is the Altmeyer brothers on the shores of Lake Weir with our paddles. And as you see, Bay's wearing all his Kawanee swag. I even have the Danny Packard Kawanee socks on today.
And Bay and I are proud to have 54 stripes on each of our paddles for the years we've been here at Kawanee. That's 108 total stripes. And we hope you guys will come back next year and add another stripe to your paddle so you can someday catch us. So,
don't forget to bring your paddles!
Cousins and my grandfather and my dad who went to camp, and I wanted to show you a couple of old Kawanee artifacts from them.
Okay, so first up, this is an old leather plaque. You guys know now you get your levels and your plaques on paper, but this is actually made of real leather. This is just a little felt pennant, a little gray and maroon for camp spirit. And then finally, this is a paddle that my grandfather, Eddie Tullis, that he carved when he was a camper in shop.
So B.A. Altmeyer actually just mailed this to me, seen this in a while. It's a message that I gave at Sunday service when I was 12, so in 2002. At camp, there's always something inside me that isn't usually there. It is like a burst of happiness. It's like a motivation to do something. It's an energy of and total excitement. It's a reflex to be spunky. And thank you, BA.
And who can forget Arch of the Week 2012?
I have a Ropes Award from 2011.
Art Award, Sonic Steve Jambulance. Jamie Bullen did this beautiful wood burning and gave it to me at the Kawanee Night Out earlier this year. This is my plaque.
I have Walter and Jane Esterbrook, my grandparents. They began running camp in 1969, right after the Frank brothers,
and ran it up until camp turned into a foundation run by a board and also helped run by the stand-ins.
So guys, even though there's only 7 weeks of camp, we actually have 8 videos coming to you guys. So that means one more video after this week. And with that comes one more challenge that Graham has posted in the last week, which is the Kawanee Testimonial Challenge. So that means that if you guys have anything you want to say about camp, how much camp means to you guys, what it's been like not having camp in your lives this summer, if you could just send a video in, we would love to hear from you guys. It doesn't matter, anyone is welcome to do it. Campers, staff, alumni, parents, anyone's welcome. The deadline's a little bit tight. It's gonna be tonight, August 2nd. So if you guys could send those videos in to KawanheeFromHome@gmail.com, that would be awesome.
Hey guys, I'm Sam.
And I'm Graham. And for those of you who don't know us, we are the producing and directing team of these videos this summer, along with Camille Tullis and Eli Yale. Wanted to say hey, and as we finish up our regular campfire videos and head into our final video next week, our closing ceremony, award ceremony type video, we felt this was the perfect time to say a couple quick words. So thank you for watching all summer. So many of you know week 7 as sort of a big week, the final week of camp, and also all sorts of exciting things happening. For us, we oftentimes correlate it with editing into the wee hours of the morning, many sleepless nights trying to prepare video work for the camp, and then probably most painful is anxiously awaiting our videos to start when we show the whole camp them and pray people enjoy them. And so it's a powerful and sometimes scary time for us.
And as we were kind of reflecting on that, we took a look back at some of the videos we made while we were both at camp, and we looked at our very first video we made together, which was when we were both SCs in 2014. As we watched it, we were really stoked to see that there were a lot of familiar faces that are still at camp, whether they are counselors or prior campers that became counselors. We also noticed a lot of really relevant messages for these really challenging, strange times that we've been battling through this summer. So we thought it was appropriate, as week 7 is drawing to a close for these videos, to take a look back at one of our past videos, the first video we made, and kind of use that to push us to our hopefully big finale we're working really hard at, and we really hope we'll get you guys excited too. So without further ado, this is 2014's Let Me In.
What makes Kawanee a special place to you?
That I know that everybody cares about me. Like, I'm not alone. Everybody wants to be friends, and I had a lot of fun here, too.
One of the memories that sticks with me the most was the championship game in my last summer there for basketball. A spirited and inspiring comeback in the rain by none other than Funtown Splashtown. It's a memory that will always stick with me. Thank you so much again to the Kawanee community for everything.
Great job! That second half was amazing. You guys worked hard, and look what happened. A win in the rain. It's a beautiful moment. Hey, all of you just did something that was big. You all did something to contribute to this game. Remember how this feels, okay?
Keep on thinking about, like, Kawanee and all the things I've taught you and how to be a better person.
Just when you're waiting for the 10 months to come back to camp, just treat everyone like they were someone you knew at Kawanee.
Day is done, gone the sun, from the lakes, from the hills, from the sky, all is well, safely rest, God is nigh. I love you, Kawanee.